I am now in the city hospital in The Hague, where I will be for another fortnight, I suppose. Before I came here, I had already been suffering for more than 3 weeks from sleeplessness and a low fever, and passing water had been very painful, and now it really does seem that I have, but in a very mild way, what they call a clap. So I have to stay here very quietly in bed, swallow many quinine pills, receive injections now and then, either of pure water or alum water, so it's all as harmless as can be, so please don't worry. But, as you know, these things must not be ridiculed, and you mustn't attempt to speed up the cure, because inattention will only aggravate it. But will you do me a favor? Don't talk about it, because you know how some people are. They sometimes exaggerate, and gossip makes things only worse. I just wanted to let you know what it is, and you mustn't be alarmed. Here, in The Hague, last winter, I met a pregnant woman, deserted by the man whose child she carried. A pregnant woman who had to wander along the streets and had to earn her living. You understand how. She first attracted my attention because she looked so ill. I couldn't pay her a full wage, but I did pay her rent, and so far, thank God, I have been able to protect her and her child from hunger and the cold by sharing my own bread with her. I went with her to Leiden. There is a maternity asylum, and she is now confined there until the birth of the child. No wonder she was ill. The child wasn't in the right position, and she had to undergo an operation. The child had to be turned with the forceps. However, there is a good chance of her pulling through, but I shan't hear from her until the birth. Every day, even the day before she went into the asylum, she came to visit me here, and she brought me always something, some bread or sugar or smoked beef, which I have to do without now, and it makes me feel very weak. But most of all, I'm so sorry that I cannot go to Leiden to bring her some extras, because the food you get in a hospital isn't exactly nourishing. When she had to leave for Leiden, I was so nervous. I think it has caused a relapse. But there are some moments in your life when you just can't keep calm. She is so alone there, and I want so badly to visit her. The days must seem so fearful to her. I don't feel for her the same passion I felt for Kay, but the kind of love I have for her, for Sien, that's her name, Christine, actually. The love I have for her is the only love I'm still capable of, especially after the disappointment of that first love. She and I, we are two unhappy people. We keep each other company and share our individual burdens together. And in this way, unhappiness is turned into happiness, and the unbearable becomes bearable. I do wish you knew Sien, but it is impossible for me to describe her in such a way that only from the description you will know her. But let me try. She isn't beautiful. No, she is slightly pockmarked. But the lines of her figure are so simple and not without grace. Her speech is ugly, and she often uses expressions which you and I wouldn't use. But I don't mind. I would rather she spoke coarsely and be good than be refined in speech but heartless. She also has a very bad temper, and sometimes she has flashes of anger That would be unbearable to most people, but I understand these things. They don't bother me, and until now I have been able to cope with them. On her side, she understands my temper. Yes, we have a kind of unspoken agreement not to criticize each other. And the things I value in her so very much are... She is not coquettish with me. She goes her way very quietly. She is thrifty and quite willing to adapt herself to whatever circumstances arise. And because she is no longer beautiful, no longer young, no longer coquettish, no longer foolish, all this makes me love her so very much. This woman, she understands me. And she told me, she said, I know you don't have very much money. And even if you didn't have a penny, I would do everything to keep you staying with me so that I can stay with you. It would be impossible for me to be alone again, she said. I need you. Well, if somebody says that to me and shows by what she does rather than by what she says, then no wonder I have lost that coldness, that roughness, that mask I have worn for such a long time, because I cannot flatter. She knows poverty, so do I. Poverty has advantages and disadvantages. In spite of poverty, we will take the risk. The fishermen, they know the dangers of the sea and they fear the storm, but despite those dangers, they have never found a reason to stroll along the beach. They leave that philosophy to others. Let the storm roar and the night come. Which is worse, danger or the fear of danger? No, I prefer the reality. Danger itself. Adieu. It's late. I'm very tired. But she's no hindrance and no trouble to me. But if she was alone, she might